your slide, you need to draw your manual slide.
Yeah, I need my manual slide. Alright, so my name is Carlos. If you don't know me, I work at Rabbit River. Today, I'm gonna just like blabber some stuff about Kafka. It's not really a proper talk. It's a bunch of like random thoughts. So a disclaimer, I'm not an expert. I have very, very little experience with Kafka. Those are mostly random thoughts. So lower expectations, you have been warned. I don't like my own voice on the bill. Okay, fine. All right, so why I like Kafka, or why was I reluctant to give this presentation? So last night I was kind of panicking because I was like, I don't know, what am I going to talk about Kafka? And we don't really need Kafka. And I was like panicking and going in circles. So my wife wanted to help me, so she came and started like asking me questions. And while I was like explaining what Kafka is, I kind of got reminded what I really liked about Kafka and why I felt reluctant about presenting about it. So first, it's Java. No hate for Java, much love. It's just personal preference. In general, I'm mostly like a Ruby, Perl, Elixir guy. And it's not that you only like one or that you hate everything else. It's just about a specific mindset. And usually when you navigate other languages, the way that they do things kind of like doesn't match the way you like to think about the problems or how you like to approach things. So there is this kind of friction. And Kafka is on the Java ecosystem, and it is everything Java feels like clunky and heavyweight, and Kafka is no different. So why I'm happy to come and talk about Redis and say, you know, you should just install Redis on your server, whether you're using it or not, and I'm pretty sure that eventually you'll find a way to use it and it's going to be good. Or I could recommend a lot of other things that you could just have as an iced tea. Nobody recommends you to use Kafka as an iced tea. It is heavy. You need to run a production cluster, you need at least 3 machines. It depends on Zookeeper, it's also a cluster, also needs 3 machines. So you can start running them together, but the bare minimum you start at is 3. So it's like, why would I come and tell people to use Kafka? It's like such a heavyweight thing. And as I was explaining this to my wife, I was like, okay, I really like, when I started, I worked with Kafka in a project, and when I started reading about it, there is one thing that I really like is some of the design decisions and the trade-offs that they have made on while building Kafka. And I find that to be like really, really, really exciting. So I think, yeah, being in a Ruby presentation on the very good Ruby style, show me the code. I just wanted to show like, okay, if you want to use, I just said that Kafka is a big, heavyweight tool, but there is really very, very little friction for you to play with it. So if you want to write something in Kafka, there is a gem called Ruby Kafka. You instantiate the Kafka with just passing the name of the broker, the IP and the port, and then you can publish message. So this is an example of using Kafka the same way you would use RabbitMQ or the same way you would use Rescue or Sidekick. So you just publish something. It could be anything. You publish into topics. So you have a synchronous way of calling it. You just say deliver message and that's it. Or you can have a producer, you call multiple times produce, and then at the end you do deliver message and it sends it in a batch. Or if you have something that produces a lot of messages, you can have an async producer, you just say, okay, just publish it whenever you reach 1,000 messages in the buffer, or whenever the 30 seconds pass. And then you just keep producing, and whenever one of those true thresholds reach, it will start publishing them on the background. And you consume, if you want to have a worker, it's very, very similar. You just instantiate the Kafka class, and then you create a consumer, you subscribe to the topic that you want, and then you do each message and you receive all of them. So if you want to play around and see how it works, there is really like not a lot of friction. You can, this is like a handful of lines and you're done. But if you want to run Kafka, that is a little bit more involved. But the same thing, if you just want to play up on it on your Dropbox, that is really, really easy. If you're using Docker, you can just copy the Kafka single node Docker compose file from Confluent, and it already has like Kafka and Zookeeper, the proper configuration so that they can talk to each other, and that's about it. So you copy that file, you do Docker compose app, you already have Kafka, and if you run those two examples with that setup, that's it. You'd be able to be ready. So what is Kafka? Well, Kafka is a commit log. Kafka is a distributed commit log. Kafka is a distributed horizontally scalable commit log. Kafka is a distributed horizontally scalable fault tolerant commit log. So it is distributed in the sense that you have multiple nodes and they act as one system. So if you have used Elasticsearch, or if you have used any of those APIs, you have an interface, and on the back end you have like multiple servers holding data. No single server is capable of hosting Google's information about the website. You make a query, it gets distributed among multiple machines, and you get a response. Kafka works the same way. You have a cluster of Kafka, and inside the cluster you have multiple nodes, and they act as one. It's horizontally scalable in the sense that you get more capacity and more performance by adding more nodes. So instead of buying bigger servers, you just buy more servers, and you can grow indefinitely with that approach by just like buying more servers. It's not cheap buying more servers, but you don't have the limit of how big a server you can buy, and it's fault tolerant, that it works in the presence of faulty nodes, and that's really important when you have something that's horizontally scalable. The more nodes you have, the higher the chance that some of them are going to be down. From what I read, all the statistics from LinkedIn where Kafka was created, they run at the time 1,300 nodes. They had a Kafka cluster with 1,300 nodes. I guarantee you, any given day, you go there, some of those nodes have some sort of problem. Kafka is designed in a way that even when some of the nodes, a subset of the nodes, are down, the system still works. Of course, all of this is configurable, and you trade ESP for durability and you got my point. But more importantly, what is Kafka? It's distributed horizontal, scalable, fault tolerant, and it's a commit log. So a commit log is an ordered append-only persistent data structure. In other systems, it's also known as write-ahead log or a transaction log. And this, the commit log, is the heart of Kafka. This is really cool, because if you understand the commit log, it's easy to understand all the other inner workings of Kafka, because everything revolves around the commit log. So what does the commit log gives it? It gives it performance, because you only write, you only append to the log, just like a log file, you just add to the end. It means that you're always doing sequential disk writes, and whenever you have your consumers, they are always doing sequential reads, and this brings extreme performance for the system. Because it uses sequential, it leverages the file system cache. The operating system is optimized for the name of the feature is read ahead, if I'm not mistaken. And whenever it's fetching data from the disk, it always reads extra blocks of data. So if you have your data sequentially on the disk, it means that more of your data, not random pieces of data, is going to be read in one go. And one very, very important thing is your reads and writes don't affect each other. So you can keep reading. You never need to find back where to insert this piece of data. It's always at the end. And it doesn't matter how fast or how slow you're writing, the readers can keep reading it until they reach the end. And there is... you don't need locking, and the data is immutable. There was another thing about this. Yeah, okay. Another thing is they scale, exactly. Okay, so when you have when you have a commit log that is append only, you decouple the performance from the data size. Because it doesn't matter if yesterday you wrote a terabyte of data, writing forward on the disk is always the same speed. If you can write 100 megabytes per second, you're going to write 100 megabytes per second today, tomorrow, and the day after tomorrow. So if you have a cluster that has very small data, 20 gigs, or if you have a cluster that has 20 terabytes, the performance of writing and reading is the same because it's always like reading sequentially, and your performance limit is on the hardware itself and not on the system that has to figure out where to put the data or when to log or unlock things. Another thing is it gives it persistence. So on the commit log, everything is immediately saved to disk. Nothing stays on RAM. So you publish something, it goes to the disk. And that might sound like counterintuitive. It's like, how can a system be performant if it never keeps the data on RAM? It always like immediately writes it to disk. And the reader has to immediately read it back from disk. And I find that this is very enlightening. They have the whole explanation about the file system on their website. They have the explanation about the design decisions, and the one about file system is like really, really, really enlightening. And at the end of that article, there is another one to a post on Varnish that is like crazy, crazy, crazy good. So especially if you haven't heard about it before, it's like the first time you read it, it's like, okay, this is really, really cool. The gist of it is that it piggybacks on the optimizations. So the operating system has a lot of optimizations for the file system, and basically everything that you write to this is not immediately written to this. It stays in the memory for a while and is written in batch. And once it's written to the disk, or once you read something from the disk, it doesn't immediately go away. The operating system will use any and every free memory as a cache for the file system. So if you do cache it yourself, what you're doing is you're implementing some less performant, less optimized version of something that the kernel already does for the file system. And it also means that when you have it on disk, you have it in memory, you need to have all the logic to decide when to write it to disk, and you need to have all the logic to decide when to read it from the internal cache in memory and when to write it to disk. And when you do write it to disk, it means you have one internal copy on your cache in memory, one copy on the file system cache, and one copy on the disk. So you're essentially holding three copies of the same data. So by just doing, I write to disk and I let the file system optimize it, you get like a lot of performance benefits. I think that those the design decisions of Kafka, particularly that one, are like what I really liked about it. And if the only thing you can take out of this talk is that, oh, I should go and check out this document, I would feel happy that I've done my job. Because it's very enlightening read, it's well written, it's an easy read, and it's very very good. So this brings us to the commit log, or why I like Kafka. It's all about the design choices and the trade-offs. Read the design document and the official internal website. It is really, really good. So what are the use cases for Kafka? One use case is like for messaging, like RabbitMQ and ActiveMQ. You can use it the same way you use one or the other. The other common use case for Kafka is activity tracking. That is the original case. So if you want to track page views, clicks, page loads, and anything that happens on an application, you can just publish all of this, and Kafka will be able to handle a lot of events per second. Another usage of it is metrics aggregation. So if you're publishing performance metrics on your application, depending on how big your application is, that can amount to a very, very big quantity of data, and Kafka is a way to handle that. It's used for log aggregation. I don't know how many of you have dealt with like collecting and indexing and making logs available for a bunch of servers. It's a nightmare. It's not fun, and Kafka is one way of dealing with that. It's done for stream processing. So once you, this kind of feedback on something that I will mention in a bit. So if you have a constant influx of data that you want to process in real time, you can use Kafka. You completely decouple your publishing from your background processing, and you can do really good stuff with Spark or Storm or Samza. Event sourcing, I'm not that familiar, but the idea is the same. You publish events, and your current state of the system is the result of playing out of all the events. Being Kafka really good at playing events of collecting data and distributing it among other systems, that's a good usage. And as a commit log, so the striking thing is, why would you use Kafka? It's usually when you have scale. If you have a lot of data, Scala is a good way of handling that data. You centralize how to collect that data and how to funnel that data to the next steps of the system. But you might think, but I don't have big data. I don't have a lot of data, but maybe could you have big data? If I told you, what about if we start collecting every single click that the user does anywhere on your website? Probably, if you don't have a system to collect a lot of data, you just say, okay, if I start sending those events, I have nowhere to place them. I have no way to deal with them. So maybe if you do have Kafka, you can handle that sort of traffic, and it's kind of an enabler. Once you have it on your system, so if you replace, let's say, RabbitMQ with Kafka, and now you have it on the system, you could say, okay, I could also publish this other type of data. I could also have this other system send metrics directly to this, and my monitoring system could pick up from those events and start automating. You could say, okay, if I wanted to start playing with like machine learning connects data, it gets a bunch of raw data, it figures out something out of it. You make questions, and based on patterns that it sees on the data, you can make decisions or predictions. So you need data to be able to start playing with any of that. So if you do have data, if you start collecting a lot of data, you can say, okay, what if I pick this, and this event, and I try to create a model to give me an answer for that? So it's either if you do have scale or if you could use the scale, then Kafka would be a good case. If you have a lot of data, if you're running a system with multiple layers, and that is the motivation for Kafka when it was created. If you have multiple layers, so your website, your mobile services, your APIs, plus the databases, plus the reporting, all of those systems, they need to communicate with each other. So your web talks to ActiveMQ, but it also talks to your relational database. It also checks a cache. And the more layers you have, the more this communication goes like from everywhere to everywhere. And it becomes really hard to change things on your architecture because there is a lot of systems depending on it. And the idea when Kafka was created was to move from that system where everything talks between themselves to something where all the applications, whenever they need to send data to someone else, they just publish it on Kafka. And any system that runs to read data into itself, it just reads from Kafka. That brings you to something really cool. So to give an example, if you want to do something every time something changes on your database, you could do that as part of the application. Whenever you make a change, you make a notification to some system. But if you have multiple applications that change that database, you'd have to do that in multiple places. You could do that as part of the database as a trigger or something. Or you can have a connector that watches to the binary log, the replication log of the database, and publish everything that happens on the database to Kafka. Kafka is performant, so it can take the load and it can receive every single change. And then you can have multiple subsystems read off the same data. You don't need to send to multiple systems. This, you send it once, and all the systems, all they need to know is how to read data from Kafka. They can all read those events, find the ones that are relevant, and if they need to make some changes to the database, they can do the opposite way. They don't change the database directly, they just publish events, and then on the database side, you have a connector that also looks to some topics in Kafka, and you're running out of battery. And that also listens to some topics in Kafka, and then apply those changes on the database. So on the database side, you create something that publishes data to Kafka and something that takes data from Kafka. And that's it. Every other system that needs to do anything related to the database can pick back on that data. And if you apply the same logic to multiple systems, you have a much more straightforward way of communicating between them. In terms of Don't get me wrong, it's not that it's magic and it's free, you still have an extra layer. You could have your application that does something very simple, talking directly to the database. And if your system is small, that's probably the best option. But if you have a complicated systems where multiple subsystems talk to each other and the data and sending data back and forth is a problem, this makes for a much more standard way of sending and receiving data back. So having a data bus on your project is one of the use cases that I like more about Kafka. That is about it. That first article is what I wanted this talk to be. It's much better than what I've said here. So if you want to see a much better version of this talk, that is the article. There are a few other presentations that I used while building this, and the Kafka introduction, and that's it.